Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I have apologies this morning from Colin Beattie and Fiona Hislop. So our first item of business is a decision to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is a consideration of a legislative consent memorandum on the UK Parliament Electronic Trade Documents Bill. This is a UK government bill introduced in the House of Lords on the 12th of October, which changes the law on devolved matters. So I welcome Richard Lockhead, Minister for Small Business, Innovation, Tourism and Trade, who is joined this morning by Chris Nicholson, Solicitor and Head of Branch, Constitutional Reform and External Affairs, Directorate for Legal Services, and David Barnes, Deputy Director, Trade Policy Directorate for International Trade and Investment, Scottish Government. I now invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement on the Scottish Government's position.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Nice to join you this morning. Thanks for the opportunity to discuss the LCM for the Electronic Trade Documents Bill. As you'll be aware, the government's committed to ensuring that Scotland is a successful trading nation, and we want to create the best conditions possible for our businesses to operate within. And one way we can do that is by harnessing advances in technology. So we are committed to take advantage of technology-based improvements to modernise trade processes and practices for Scottish enterprises, and in doing so deliver benefits, of course, for the people of Scotland. So it's vitally important that the Scottish legal system is tailored to help us realise those ambitions, to provide a competitive platform for our businesses to operate, and to support the businesses we want to create tomorrow as well, to be adapted to the modern world. Now, the Electronic Trade Documents Bill is designed to do just that, to bring trading processes into the 21st century by giving electronic documents used for the purposes of trade the same legal standing as paper documents. This simple and common sense measure will immediately remove burdens for businesses who choose to operate in a more digital way, and it will create a more streamlined and modern trading system. This is something that Scottish businesses should be able to take advantage of in the future. The bill has been brought forward by the Law Commission of England and Wales in recognition that this is an area of law in need of reform. Not only has there been significant engagement with Scottish legal and academic stakeholders, the bill did go through an expedited process in Westminster, given that it's highly technical and uncontroversial in nature. So therefore, as a government, we support and welcome the policy intentions of this bill, which aligns squarely with our ambitions for the future of the trading landscape in Scotland. I should say, of course, unfortunately, despite our views on the policy intent of the bill, the Scottish Government could not support it as it was introduced due to the drafting of delegated powers. As drafted, the bill conferred powers on UK ministers to make secondary legislation in areas of devolved competence, and it gave UK ministers the ability, for example, to unilaterally disapply parts of the bill's regime in Scotland in devolved areas, so that paper documents would once again be needed. UK ministers would be required to consult Scottish ministers, who would express concern, perhaps, or disapproval, but Scottish ministers could not prevent the UK government from legislating in devolved areas. The Scottish Government has therefore spent considerable time defending the interests of the Scottish devolved institutions and negotiating with the UK Government to secure amendments to the bill. But the process has been constructive, lengthy, and of course, as a result of it being lengthy, it led to a delay in the LCM being lodged. So of course, I want to take this opportunity to apologise to the committee for the delay and to stress that both myself and my officials recognise the important role that the committee has in the process. With the benefit of hindsight, had we known it would take this long to conclude discussions with the UK Government, we would have lodged in the LCM much earlier. I am, though, pleased to report that amendments have now been formally tabled by the UK Government, and we anticipate them to be voted through without concern in the coming days. This has enabled the Scottish Government yesterday to lodge a supplementary legislative consent memorandum with the Scottish Parliament recommending consent to the bill on the basis of these amendments. I'm very hopeful that this development allows us to secure the benefits of the bill, modernising our trade processes, delivering benefits to Scottish traders, those who trade with us, and of course the economy overall. So once again, I thank the committee for your time this morning, and of course we'll do our best to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Minister. If I just start with a couple of questions about process, I welcome that you recognise the delay that has been in introducing the LCM. That is a bit of a feature of Parliament at the moment, and it's quite frustrating for committees not to get proper scrutiny. So I do accept the apology for the lodging of the LCM quite late. You've indicated that if you had realised it was going to take so long, there might have been an option to introduce it sooner. Well, has there been lessons learned from this process? Would that be something you'd consider going forward? And also at the Conveners Group, there's been a discussion around whether we could look at kind of interim LCMs or pre-LCMs, just a way so that the committee can be involved earlier.
The answer to your first question is yes, we'll do our best to learn lessons. The background really is that you're dealing with a technical, uncontroversial bill, but there are issues of concern within that. So there were constructive negotiations to sort that out. Clearly it took some time to do that. And I guess it's striking a balance between the fact you're dealing with something that's potentially uncontroversial and technical, but with the fact you've got concerns. But because it was generally uncontroversial, perhaps we could have just lodged the LCM earlier in anticipation of negotiations hopefully being successful, and because it's not the most highly political issue in the world. Interested to hear about the conveners discussing a kind of interim LCM that potentially could be a solution to that kind of scenario.
Okay, thank you. And now that the government have recommended acceptance of the LCM, there are maybe some questions remain over Scottish Parliament's role in scrutinising future pieces of legislation, well, future pieces of work that come attached to this LCM. Where would you see the opportunities for the Scottish Parliament to look at proposals that are coming through? I understand Scottish Government ministers would be able to introduce measures, and you would be consulted by the UK Government on measures that would affect Scotland. Where do you see Scottish Parliament committees fitting into this scrutiny process?
Well, if secondary legislation was used, then the process that would follow would involve the committees of the Parliament. There's a wider policy implications as well in terms of how we work with trade moving from paper to electronic. So I think it's quite difficult to predict any scenarios. The powers that the UK government are retaining, they have said they're unlikely to use other than extreme circumstances. So, for instance, the amendments are not perfect that the UK government brought forward. They move us much more forward in terms of recognising the role of Scottish ministers in relation to devolved matters. But of course, UK governments retain the ability to disapply certain parts of the bill in extreme circumstances. So, for instance, if there was a cyber attack or IT systems failed and a decision was taken that we had to revert to paper for certain trade documents, they've said only under those circumstances would they use those powers. So clearly, we would have to respond to that at the time. But so it's against that kind of comforting background that we are not too concerned about there being many further interventions in terms of changes. But who knows?
Because there would be instances where the UK government would consult the Scottish government, but it wouldn't necessarily come to committees. But you're suggesting this because it would be an extreme and kind of rare circumstances that scenario would come around.
So that's what we anticipate, and that's what we've been assured by the UK government. But of course, I will undertake to keep the committee informed should anything arise in relation to that.
Thank you. Is there any other questions, Graham Simpson?
Yeah, thanks. So if you'd introduced an LCM earlier, do you think you would have been in a position to say yes?
I guess that's a good question. I can't really give a clear answer to, because we don't know how the negotiations have gone as a result of just tabling the LCM at the time. What we're trying to convey is that it has been an extraordinary length of time, and we could have perhaps envisaged hopefully a successful outcome to allow us just to have tabled the LCM to give the committee its opportunity and appropriate timescale to do its work. But the way things have transpired, we're content to support it and lodged LCM.
Yeah. I mean, I'm quite comfortable with the way you've done it, because it just seemed, you know, even though it's taken a bit of time, you've actually arrived at a conclusion, and you know, everybody's got round the table and talked sensibly, and you know, changes have been made, and you're now in a position to recommend acceptance. So I think that's a mature way of going about things. Can you just explain for the committee what were the main sticking points originally? I know they've been ironed out, but just so that we can understand that.
The main sticking point originally was the lack of recognition for the ability for Scottish ministers to be given delegated powers in devolved areas. So it's essentially ignored, and just for the UK ministers to override and intervene in devolved areas. Now, in many other bits of legislation, you'll all be aware, are much more controversial where that occurs, and there's a much more of a political argument. Clearly, what we're dealing with here is a law reform, and the whole reason why it's expedited in the House of Commons is because law reform recommendations, or Law Commission recommendations in relation to law reform, are uncontroversial and technical. So that was the background.
Okay, thank you.
Any questions? Jamie Hacker-Johnson.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. There were two things I wanted to ask about. I mean, firstly, just to get a bit of an idea of what documents might be included in this, whether there are any probably notable exceptions that might be included, and how far does it go down? So, for example, does it include potentially health certificates that can be part of cross-border trade and things like that?
So, in the bill, there's a list of documents that are affected, and I'm just working through my papers to get the list that's on the bill. So thank you to David for just handing me that. So clearly there's a list in 1.2 giving examples. So a bill of exchange, a bill of lading, a ship's delivery order, a warehouse receipt, a mate's receipt, a marine insurance policy, a cargo insurance certificate, and so on.
Yeah.
I don't know if Chris, from a legal perspective, wants to maybe comment on how wide that list would go, because private transactions are kind of devolved, mm-hmm. but clearly a lot of this is interacting with reserved issues, and it's a very complex area, mm-hmm. because it's been built up over hundreds of years of commercial trading. So the whole one of the key points of supporting an LCM is that to get into an argument over what's devolved and what reserved, we could be here for years, because you're talking about untangling hundreds of years of commercial trading, and to actually ascertain exactly what's reserved, what's devolved, yeah. built up over. And that's why the bill does refer to also and recognises customs that are built up over time, custom practice. So it's quite complex. But Chris might want to just talk about some of the technical detail.
Certainly. Thank you, Minister. I think it's important to note that the list in subsection 2 is not exhaustive. It's there to give some examples. But you'll see the way clause 1 and subsection 1 of clause 1 operates. It's quite a wide gloss they're trying to apply in these circumstances. But I think to answer the question, I would have to know what normally comes with health products, and then you'd circle back to see if they'd come within this definition. It may be the case that they don't. It may be a simple contract whereby somebody wants to buy medical products and they get them. In a straight kind of contract. It may be the case for larger supplies that they may apply here, but it depends on the scale and what you would normally see customarily in relation to health products. If there's any particular examples, we can...
I suppose it really just comes back from as we left the EU and in the last few years, there's been a number of examples, etc., where there have been delays in trade because of paper documents having to be used. And I was wondering how far down, as simple as, I say, things like health certificates relating to food exports or something like that, and how far that went down, whether this was kind of including these sorts of things as well. Some of that has become electric, but whether that, digital, but whether that these would be kind of included as a standard now. But I could maybe look further into that.
Okay.
Okay. And the other thing I was just going to ask, in terms of I suppose the approach that this does this mean that there will be a kind of uniform approach across the UK single market, or is there still the potential for different regulations, requirements, etc. within the UK?
Well, it certainly smooths trade, yes, because, you know, it makes sense for the same laws to apply in common trade areas. So removing the obligation to use paper is clearly something that's in the interests of trade in Scotland, England, Wales, Northern Ireland, so it's a perfectly sensible option.
Thanks very much. Thanks.
Thank you. Can I just ask, so you said that there'd be Jamie Harkle-Johnson's question on different requirements within the UK. Where does the Law Society of Scotland's views fit into this? I think they've made some comments about laws of possession are not identical. The law is different around intangible property doesn't apply in Scotland. Would that just be for then Scottish Government ministers to make the required changes in that area?
I think that reference, and again I'll have to ask Chris to come in with his legal mind, but the reference, the Law Society were keen to emphasise that some parts of this are devolved, and those references were really to explain their recognition that this is an area that crosses between devolved and reserved areas. It's giving examples of where there are devolved areas, because people may think trade is reserved, and clearly many aspects are, particularly in relation to marine maritime industries, whereas private transactions and some other aspects, such as one you just highlighted, are devolved.
Yeah, so there would be it would be the responsibility of the Scottish Government to make the changes in these areas, and it has to be in line with this piece of legislation.
Well, yes, now the bill with the amendments gives delegated powers to Scottish ministers. If ministers in Scotland felt there was a reason to intervene, they would have those powers to identify devolved areas.
Mm-hmm. And does at the moment the government have an idea of whether they are going to intervene and make changes in these areas, or is that still something that's under consideration?
No, because the thrust, well, not at the moment, because the thrust of the legislation is to make a very sensible move from paper to electronic trading and make sure that the interests of devolution are protected within that bill should something arise in the future where Scottish ministers feel they have to intervene. Okay. So it's, you know, we are not predicting any particular scenario at the moment, but it's important to protect the fact that because parts of the trading environment are devolved, the Scottish ministers retain the legal right to intervene.
Okay, but if you agree with
it, something maybe just.
Certainly, I think it's just going back to the Mr. Harkle-Johnson's point and your follow-up, convener, is simply to note that you're always going to have slight divergence between the jurisdictions within the UK about how these documents come to be used, because you're using different courts, you've got different legal jurisdictions, so there'll always be different rules and ways the courts apply things around that. That being said, that most of the documents listed, as you can see, are quite commonly known within the UK. Some are devolved for reserved purposes, some have been unified over time at a UK level, like bills of exchange and promissory notes. So there is some... there's a form of alignment and understanding within the UK what these documents are and what you're entitled to if you have one of these documents, how they stand to be applied or interpreted in the jurisdictions sometimes diverges, but that's always been the case. And as a result, there's not understood to be any need to change that at the moment. I think the Law Society's comments were about recognising the benefit in proceeding on a UK basis, so there wouldn't be divergence if you started to have two different regimes in place.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, I understand the difference between the reserved and devolved aspects. What I'm asking is, once the bill is passed, is it the intention of the Scottish Government to move towards electronic documents in these areas? Or is that something that is being considered, or does that make sense?
Yeah. Well, we support the policy aim of moving towards electronic trading, and this bill clearly sets course for that to be legally possible, so that's why we're supporting it. And the bill in itself will give the right to Scottish traders to use digital where they want to give them the choice.
Okay.
It's a choice, they're getting a choice.
Okay.
Whereas a law at the moment says basically it's got to be paper. Generally it's got to be paper. Therefore,
And given your support of the policy intention of the bill, it's something you would be encouraging within Scotland to move towards. I suppose the final question is just around the issue of consent. And we have had a number of LCMs. It is one of the areas in which the government have previously recommended not to give approval to LCMs because of the issue of consent. While there has been compromise on this piece of legislation, it's not gone as far as to introduce consent as a mechanism. Would you say there's just... In this case, what's the reason for that? You've explained it's technical. So has there been a consensus reached? Has been a compromise reached? And is that a model for any future LCMs? Or is this one too particular? Because it is the issue that, you know, the cause and the committee frequently do support the government in that approach. And in this instance, we've been asked to, you know, to compromise and to not give that the level of importance it has in other LCMs.
Yeah. Well, essentially, every bit of legislation has to be looked at upon its merits. And in this case, as I said in my opening remarks, it's a technical, uncontroversial issue. No one thinks it's a bad idea to move to electronic trading from paper in this day and age, given all the benefits. But clearly, we know there are disputes in other areas. So each bit of legislation has to be treated in its merits. And in this case, you know, we're pragmatic. We are, of course, open to compromise. It's, as I said before, the amendments in the UK government are not perfect, but they're good enough. And for that reason, we're content to lodge the LCM.
And I haven't been here as long as the Minister, but is this previously how LCMs would tend to operate? They would involve negotiation and consensus, and we had less divisions on LCMs, I think, than we have in more recent years.
I can only speak from personal experience from previous ministerial roles where I've had many LCMs, and... generally speaking, we listen to stakeholders, we look at the impact, we judge each one, as I said, on its merits, and in the past I've supported many LCMs which just made sense just to allow the UK government to take forward something for a range of reasons, you know, just because there's no point duplicating efforts sometimes, because it'll deliver quicker benefits. We'd have done it anyway. So, you know, there's just different reasons. But clearly, across government, there are many more disputes in other areas, because ultimately, as a parliament, we have to defend devolution. And you know, I'm sure that's the view of the committee as well, that there'll be times where you think compromise is appropriate, and there's times where compromise is not appropriate because devolution's been undermined. So it's just a case of a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, I think it's recognised that the environment for LCMs has changed quite a bit in recent years, but I think the committee... welcomes the evidence we've heard this morning, and we'll consider a report in due course. So I'll bring this evidence. Does anyone else have any questions? No. I'll bring this session to an end. Thank you for attending this morning.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much for your time.
And I'll briefly suspend while we change witnesses. So our next item of business is an evidence session on Registers of Scotland's activities and performance. The Registers of Scotland is a non-ministerial office and part of the Scottish Administration with direct accountability to the Scottish Parliament. And responsibility for scrutiny does fall mainly to this committee. So I once again welcome Jennifer Henderson, Keeper of the Registers of Scotland, and she's joined by Christopher Kerr, Interim Accountable Officer and Registration and Policy Director, Registers of Scotland. I now invite the Keeper to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to meet with you today and give you an update on ROS's progress, and I'm delighted to make a brief opening statement. I'm joined today by Chris Kerr, who is now our Interim Accountable Officer and so will be able to offer insight on ROS's finances, and also in his role as Registration and Policy Director can speak to the detail on areas such as managing casework and delivering the benefits of a complete land register. I'm pleased to tell the committee we've made progress across all our strategic objectives since our last appearance, and we will be able to accelerate this progress in the year ahead. In April, we shared with you our delivery plan for 2023-24 that provides the year two detail for our overarching corporate plan, which takes us from 2022 to 2027. And we've set ourselves stretching targets, in particular around processing casework, which remains our top priority. The strategy we've put in place has meant that we've stabilised the volume of open casework cases, meeting or exceeding our targets in processing new applications, and meeting or exceeding our targets for clearing our older casework. We've also increased our processing of first registrations by 5% and transfers of part by 24%. But I do want to acknowledge that we know from talking to customers that we still have more to do in terms of meeting their expectations, and we do not underestimate the concerns that having an open case can cause. But I would emphasise that the vast majority of customers are satisfied with the service they receive from ROS, as evidenced by our consistently high customer satisfaction scores from both legal professionals and citizens. Last year, we implemented a more detailed customer service benchmarking system, which provides us with useful insight into what we get right and where we need to improve. On transparency of land ownership, we continue to make good progress in delivering the benefits of a complete land register, and our total landmass coverage is now 90.7%, an increase of 7% since we met in September last year. And to support the effective and efficient delivery of our services, we've continued to build and develop our online offering. Since our last evidence session, we are now able to accept digital applications to the Register of Deeds. So that means every register we run now accepts digital applications and can provide digital extracts. Our workforce planning approach is now fully in place, and it has confirmed that the number of colleagues we need to employ will remain broadly unchanged while we work to clear our open casework and deliver the benefits of a complete land register. But over the course of the corporate plan, as we deliver service improvements, we expect to need 10% fewer people to deliver our services by the time we reach the end. And finally, I'm pleased to say that we're on course to break even again this year for the third consecutive year. Thank you. Chris and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you very much. I'll now move to questions from members. I will go first to Colin Smith, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I start with some questions on the staffing projections, which you mentioned in your opening statement, and particularly what this means for your current workforce? You said again that the size of the workforce is expected to fall by 10% by 2027, despite obviously the big challenges over that backlog of work. But I think it's fair to say it hasn't been clear to the committee, therefore I assume your staff, what your projected fall in workforce would actually mean in terms of how many people would be carrying out which particular roles. I think we previously commented at a previous session that your corporate plan had lots of diagrams of big people and little people in each department, but no numbers to go with those particular graphics. Now, you've said you don't project any reduction in staffing until 2025-26 in your most recent delivery plan. So how will that 10% reduction be achieved by 2027? And are you, and I suppose therefore your staff, any clearer what this means in terms of the exact size of the teams carrying out the different tasks?
What might be useful to do is just sort of explain some of the things we're bringing in that will replace some colleagues' work, so how are we going to achieve that reduction, and then explain how we expect to deliver the reduction. So one of the big things that's coming in the next year or two will be automating some of our most simple work. So the colleagues who do that work are our most junior grades. We have in place an upskilling programme so that as that work is replaced with automation, they are upskilled to take on the more complex work. And we have really four grades of work that do our registration work. Our most senior grade, a huge number of those people are due to retire in the not too distant future. Over 25% of our workforce is over 50 or over 55 in the kind of, so we'll be coming up to retirement. So we have a programme essentially to replace that skill set. So as those people retire, we have the right skills to do the more complex work. And it's the more complex work that will be the work that still needs people, because the more simple work will be done by automation. So we expect to be able to deliver that workforce reduction through natural attrition, if you like, mostly through people retiring, and we have in place the plans to upskill people so that we have the right sort of shape of skills for the work that's going to be needed done by people. I don't know, Chris, did you want to add anything to that?
No, I don't think so, Jennifer. Thank you. That's very full.
So just to be clear, you're confident that the changes in the workforce will effectively be achieved through that natural process of existing staff either moving to new roles or staff retiring? There were no plans at all to carry out any, redundancy process?
No, none of our projections suggest that would be necessary.
Okay. Well, you touched on the impact of automation and artificial intelligence on staff numbers. I mean, what assessment have you done on that potential of AI on service delivery, and to what extent is that likely to impact on those staffing numbers? I mean, I presume it's ongoing work that you're carrying out at the moment, and the full potential hasn't yet been seen.
We have a detailed plan for the introduction of automation, and we have estimates from that of the amount of work currently carried out by individuals that will be replaced by computers. And broadly, we're thinking over the next year, somewhere as we introduce automation, it'll be somewhere between 10 and 20 people at our most junior grades whose work could be taken by automation, which is good news because we've got plans in place to upskill those people. So if we weren't replacing it by automation, we'd be having to think about hiring people in. And the year beyond that, we expect to be able to extend the automation work, and that will be between 40 and 60 people, which again is good news because that is when some of our more mature colleagues really will start moving to retirement. So that pipeline of pulling people through. The thing I would caveat that with is we are in the early stages of introducing automation, so we've got to prove it works, but everything we're doing suggests it's going to work and it will free up those people to be retrained and move into the more senior grades.
To just be clear then, you're confident that 10% reduction, which is quite later on in your corporate plan, the sort of final couple of years, will be achieved, but it will have no impact on tackling that backlog and the work of
I mean, that's exactly why we don't forecast the 10% reduction till later in the corporate plan, because the stock of open casework we have broadly needs more senior people to work on it. The majority of the work that comes to us new is the work that can be done more simply and by the more junior grades. So if we automate that work, we free people up, we retrain them, we have more people working on the backlog, which is how we're able to accelerate it. And then as colleagues start to retire and we diminish the backlog, we're left with the right number of people to take the complex work forward, because there will always be complex work coming into ROS, but we won't have the volume of it that we currently have while we're working on clearing the backlog. So, I mean, I'd be really happy going forward in our quarterly updates to include a specific strategic workforce plan update if the committee would find that useful, because we can give you where are we at with the numbers, what are we projecting, if that would be useful to sort of track it as we go through between evidence sessions.
Thank you. I'm going to allow Graham Simpson a brief supplementary before I bring in Maggie Chapman.
Yeah, so supplementary on staffing. You know that the world of work has changed, certainly since the pandemic. A lot more people are now working from home. How's it affected you?
So ROS has introduced a hybrid working policy, and we've empowered our teams to work out how they best deliver the work they're charged with. So that means we have a mixture of people working in the office, working some of the time in the office, and working more from home. We've managed to retain the levels of productivity we used to see in the office with that mixture of work. And what's particularly pleasing is we've increased our quality, and we think that's because many of our colleagues, the work they do is very concentrating work. So actually, for those colleagues, if they choose to do it from home, they can really get their heads down and focus, and we think that's why the quality's driven up. But it's not had an impact negatively on our productivity. We've managed to maintain the productivity, and for that reason we've recently signed off on a hybrid working policy that says this is how we intend to work going forward, because it works for us.
Are people expected to come in a certain number of days, or is there flexibility around that?
No, there's absolute flexibility, because we've said to the teams, you all do different jobs, you work out which bits of what you do are better. So, I mean, I'll give you an example. We had some people being trained in new work. That was better done on site, bringing people together. So when we induct new people, there's opportunities for them to come on site, but it is flexible to do the work that needs doing.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman will be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much. And good morning. Thank you for being with us again today. Following on, thinking about your staffing mix, you've previously talked about the contractors you use and the specialised work that they do. And, of course, in your corporate plan, there's that planned reduction in reliance on contractors. Can you just provide us with an update of how that's going?
Yes. So the committee will recall that we've previously discussed some of the challenges we have with recruiting people into permanent roles to fill. Most of our contractors deliver our digital work. So the way we've been largely delivering that is running something called a Grow Our Own programme. So taking people at the junior grades, another example of where we're upskilling junior grades, putting them through a very intensive programme to teach them digital skills, and then deploying them into our digital directorate. It's been very successful. What it doesn't yet do is give us the senior people at the digital grades, because it's about growing people in the organisation. So one of the things we're working on at the moment is a kind of attraction strategy for what is it we need to do to persuade senior people to want to join us. We've had some success. We've had, interestingly, some people who have previously contracted for us, who when the opportunity to join us permanently comes up, they've chosen to jump across, which is good news. But it's something we need to do more on in the years ahead. I think it's probably also true to acknowledge that, you know, our most important focus is clearing our open casework. So we've been doubling down on making sure we have the right skills in our registration staff to do that. And as that is starting to get itself sorted, we want to turn our attention to this thorny problem of the more senior digital staff. But meanwhile, we've got junior staff coming through and developing, so we're filling up from the bottom as well as seeking to hire in the middle.
Okay, no, that makes sense. And I suppose it is good news to hear that people who come in as contractors see it as a good place, an attractive proposition, and want to jump on board. In the corporate plan, and we discussed this previously, that one of the reasons for wanting to sort of shift the balance to away from contractors was around cost. Are those projections still what you're aiming for, the sort of cost savings? Or
it's both about cost, and it's about the longevity of knowledge. So at the moment, we're doing a lot of building of digital systems, and actually we need more digital people than we're going to need in the future to do that. Once those digital systems are built, it is better for us to have a greater number of permanent people responsible for the maintenance. I mean, we've had a big programme of work in ROS to what we call reduce our technical debt. We've got lots of legacy IT systems that we've had to unpick and rebuild. We now want to make sure our technical debt stays low, and the best way to do that is to have a decent proportion of our digital directorate staffed with people who are here for the longer term, because by their nature, and rightly, people who come in and contract for us, they come in, they do a very specific job, and then usually they move on to something else. So it's both cost saving, it will cost us less, but it's also a strategic choice around the best way of maintaining our digital systems going forward.
And I suppose there's something about staff morale as well, and integrity of the staff team, having people who are there for the long term. Is that, I mean, how is morale, given what you say, the successes you've had with dealing with the backlog, and also the increase of 7% you mentioned of the land register?
I think morale is good. I mean, we do a number of different evidence, I suppose, collect a number of different sorts of evidence to suit that. I mean, I'll give you an example. Last year, we undertook an external assessment around investor in wellbeing, which looks at whether staff feel supported in the workplace, able to do their jobs. We came out very well from that assessment. We got our gold accreditation. We get very good engagement in everything we do in ROS. When we recently ran an all-staff event on site where people came in, really good attendance at that to sort of see about the future direction. So I think morale is good, but it's something we're very mindful of making sure we maintain and get the balance right, focusing on the open casework, thinking about delivering our strategic workforce plan, but maintaining a happy, healthy workforce while we do that is very important.
And my last question, focusing on staff and contractors, how are inflationary pressures affecting your sort of staff and contractor budgets? Are there significant challenges within that beyond the general challenges of inflation?
Some challenges. Chris may want to speak to this because it's a sort of financial question. I mean, some challenges, but we do work hard to mitigate the impact of financial pressures. I don't know, Chris, did you want to say something on the kind of cost inflation piece?
Yes, so I think that's fair comment from Jennifer. Cost inflation is a challenge for us, but at the moment, and we are projecting for this year and going forward, that we will be able to meet that out of the fees that we bring in for our services, and partly that's due to the good progress we've made in clearing the open casework and improving efficiency and delivery of those registration services, which drives the income of the organisation and is allowing us at the moment to balance that. But there certainly are challenges, I think.
So in terms of pay settlements, you don't see any significant issues in the next year or two?
No, we think they will be manageable.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Thanks very much, convener. And just to continue this conversation, so these questions might be for you, Chris. When you appeared in front of the committee, Jennifer, last year, you indicated that there was going to be a surplus of $10 million. Turned out it was actually $11 million, so that was a good estimate. Are you able to give similar figures for the year just completed?
Yes, we can do it. So, subject to the usual caveat of the finally audited accounts, we think there will be a surplus in the region of £2 million.
OK. Can you say about how that was achieved? Was it because increased income or reduced costs or a bit of both?
It was a combination of both. Broadly, I would say around a third in terms of increased income and the remainder from cost reduction.
OK. One of the things I picked up in your report was your savings, and you said that using the Scottish Government's procurement methodology, you save £1.96 million, or 6.5% of annual expenditure, excluding salaries, obviously. Is that something that was a one-off, or is it savings that you can see, and how did you achieve that nearly £2 million saving?
So I think... Due to the hard work of our procurement team, I think, who are very high performing, in combination with our digital colleagues, as Jennifer mentioned, one of the benefits of having contractors in that space is that they know the marketplace very well. So we've got a lot of good information in house around what the rates are that we should be paying for various things, and then we. Are strong, I would say, in negotiations with suppliers around costs.
Okay. So, we've already touched upon the fact that there's a huge amount of volatility in the market at the moment. We've got the high cost of living, ongoing inflation. We've got uncertainty over mortgage rates. And, at least today, we've had one house builder that said that there is a 25% reduction year on year on the reservation rates. So, if that level of volatility is out there in the market, how does your income and expenditure projection show you being balanced using the central income projection number for your income? How are you able to achieve a balanced budget year on year?
So it's a combination, I would say, of those efficiencies that we're delivering. A slowdown in the market allows us to go faster on the open casework, which will release additional income. So there is income there to be released. I think also it turns quite strongly on particularly what happens to the market in a slowdown. Mm-hmm. So quite often what we will see there is that the number of applications coming to us won't reduce, but what will happen will be that the mix of applications will change in terms of whether they are transfers apart, whether they're dealings or whether they're remortgage applications. So we have a range of scenarios, and I think in our midline scenario, I think we are content that income will cover costs over the period of the plan. We do, of course, have opportunities to raise additional income if that is required in a very strong market crash scenario. But at the moment, we're not projecting that we are going in that direction.
Okay. And my last question is about your expenditure. The four-year projection, you've got expenditure rising, between 1% and 2% year on year. Given that two-thirds of your total costs is your staff, and given we're in a period of inflation, it's unlikely that pay awards are going to be settled at the 1% or 2% mark, I would have thought. So, you know, is the pay award going to be predicated on reduced staffing? Is that how you're going to achieve your budget?
So I think obviously we will, we're in line with public sector pay policy. I think we are content that in the next year, looking at the 4 or 5% that central government have mentioned, that is achievable. I think in future years, we will need to continue to model that. I think the overall reduction in headcount, which Jennifer mentions, and the reduction in cost that brings is a factor. There are other areas where we could look to reduce costs if we needed to, as well as trying to maximise income. So, in particular, driving down the open casework more quickly brings in more income over that period to bridge us to the point where the headcount reduction comes into play.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you, Jamie Harper-Jones.
Thanks very much. Yeah, Chris, just on those points you made there, you talked about the slowdown, I suppose, of the market. I mean, you can I think you use the term unlock, essentially unlock some existing casework, which means that brings in additional income. You talked there about bridging, etc. Does that mean you're not dealing with those cases as quickly as possible? Are they essentially being kind of banked, as it were? No.
I think, as I think we maybe mentioned to the committee last time, there's three areas where we're putting our capacity in terms of casework. So the first area is in new cases that are coming into us, and the reason for doing that is to stop the backlog perpetuating. And also, as Jennifer says, then that allows us to introduce streamlined processes and automation, which then frees up people. So that's why we're focusing on new casework. Second area we focus on our capacity on is around expedite cases. So those are cases that customers tell us have a degree of urgency, and we ensure that we meet them. And then the final area of capacity is on the oldest casework on the stock to clear that open casework. So plainly, if the cases coming in the door reduce in number, there is additional capacity which we can deploy to expedite cases or the oldest cases. Separate to that and in conjunction with that, as the Keeper mentioned, we have a plan which is to build capacity across that range anyway. So a slowdown in the upfront market allows us to do it more quickly, but the plan is to do it in any event over the duration of the corporate plan.
So these are cases that there isn't an urgency, there isn't much of an impact, the kind of historic cases, are they the ones that are being left?
I think all cases are important to us, but certainly they are not cases that we are being asked to expedite by customers. And we are getting through them as quickly as we can. We've accelerated this year, plan to accelerate in the year we're just going into to get to a position at the end of the corporate plan where we've cleared them completely.
Okay. So given the funding model has changed, you're not expecting to draw down any additional support from the Scottish Government over this?
No.
Over this plan? Okay, thanks very much. I just had another question. Regards to the cases, you've obviously got a number of older cases open. I think you've covered how you're looking to achieve some of that. When do you expect to essentially have cleared the majority of those cases? You probably won't hit 100%, but
over the duration of this corporate plan, up to 27.
And you're confident you'll achieve that?
Yes.
Okay. And in terms of the impact, I mean, I don't know if you do any economic impact assessment yourselves or with some of your clients, customers. on the economic impact, the impact on their businesses of these, of potential delays of outstanding cases?
So we do talk to our customers all the time, and we appreciate that the mitigations that they have to put in place, as we do as well, in terms of expedites and avoiding rejections. That our strong preference would be that there was no necessity for those for those mitigations. So that is why it's our fundamental priority to clear them. And we do, I think, everything that we can in that space to lessen the impact and reduce the impact on customers.
Because I think the business survey that you did had, against the kind of national framework, quite a high level of satisfaction. Is that across all cases? Can that be differentiated between clients that have been waiting for some time?
I can come in on that if it's helpful, Chris. Yeah. So we can, the survey's anonymous, so we don't definitively know who's reporting on it, but one of the reasons we moved to the customer, the greater detail of benchmarking with the Institute of Customer Services is precisely because you get that granular. If you're not fully satisfied, why not? And it is true to say that the speediness of the turnaround of cases is an ongoing issue for a reason for dissatisfaction. And we definitely see less satisfaction in those customers who've had to get in touch to chase a case. So it tells us we're doing the right thing to focus on this as our top priority. The other thing I would just say on the economic impact piece is we're always very clear. If a customer has an open case with us, it doesn't stop them transacting on their property. It doesn't stop them remortgaging. And if there is any issue with that, which is very, very unlikely, that's where the expedite service comes in. So that direct impact on people is why we are able to mitigate in that way. But as Chris says, it's why it's our top priority to get rid of it so that people are never having to chase up for a case because it's done.
I suppose just on that, because I mean, I think, the engaging with your customers and looking for that feedback, particularly on the business side, is important. Well, across all sides are important. I take it you would expect if you went to the, I think it's 2,435 cases open from 2007, the proportion of those that might be less satisfied, let's put it positively, than the 20,598 open from 2019, you would expect probably a high proportion of the earlier cases to be dissatisfied because of the time. So why don't you collect that?
For the most part, I mean, clearly, and we absolutely appreciate, there are individual people, citizens, at the end of those cases. But the main sort of interlocutor for those citizens is the solicitor customer. And they will have a range of cases with us. They will have cases that they sent to us today. And in fact, we're now getting cases back to customers the same day. And if that's a great proportion of what they get back, the significance of the longer standing open cases is smaller in proportion. But
would it not be helpful for you to know where the concerns are, where the frustrations are? By at least, it doesn't have to be, I appreciate it could be anonymous, but could anonymous still with a marker in terms of when the case was open?
So perhaps it's helpful if I add the additional, the customer satisfaction survey is not the only way in which we understand what issues are for customers. We have a team of customer relationship managers, and they're very proactive in speaking on a regular basis to all our customers and talking to them about, making sure they understand the expedite service, understanding whether they have particular cases that are starting to bubble up as things they're worried about. We had an example recently of a solicitor who was retiring, got in touch, had a good conversation with him about when he was retiring, how we could make sure that the cases he had with us were done. So that ongoing engagement with our customers through customer satisfaction survey, anonymous, regular dialogue, we run regular webinars. There's lots of ways in which we're making sure on a day-to-day basis we understand what it is our customers need us to prioritise, and lots of messaging about what we are doing to focus on clearing the longer standing open casework, which I think is one of the reasons why our overall customer satisfaction has risen slightly in the most recent survey, because customers are really seeing what we're doing, they're seeing it's having an impact, and they've got increased confidence that it is going to get the problem resolved in the timeframes we're talking about.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to bring in Graeme Simpson for a supplementary, but could I first of all just maybe ask, in replying to Jamie Hugwell-Johnson, you've said that by the end of the corporate plan, the backlog would be cleared completely, but in statements in 2022, you've kind of said there's no definition of a backlog, there's no strict definition, and there will always be some cases that are... So what is the kind of time frame for a case that would maybe still not be resolved? Is there service standards around this, or what could people expect? Because will there not be a backlog, or is it an understandable backlog will be different, or what is it we're aiming towards for 27?
I'm sure Chris and I will answer this question between us, but what we want to have happen is that when a case comes to us, it is constantly in work. So we get some cases, we open them up, we go, this is 6 months' work. This is 6 months ploughing away at the mapping and the legal stuff, and it's going to take 6 months to deliver it. Other cases get done on the same day. So the goal is to get to the point where when a customer sends us a case, the vast majority of cases will go back within that 35-day standard that we set. But if it's very obvious right at the beginning, there's more work, we're having that discussion with the customer about how long is it going to take us, when are you going to get it back? And that requires us to have got rid of all those cases that at the moment we haven't got the capacity to be fully doing them all the time, which is why, as answering earlier to Mr. Smith's question, bringing in the automation frees up the people, allows us to get more capacity on those open cases and reduce all those open cases that have been with us not moving because they've slipped the net. We've just not had the capacity to deal with them. Chris, do you want to come in? Because it is a thorny question about how we define open cases versus long-standing open cases.
So I think that's right. I think we will, as Mr. Johnson said in the question, it may not be 100%. There may be some cases that we are still working on, but we expect the long-standing open cases to be cleared. And as Jennifer says, the position we want to move to is a position where customers have absolute certainty about how long an application is going to take, and that will come from the case being one of our more standard cases, which is around 80% of our work, that can be done within that 35-day period, which aligns to the period of protection from an advance notice. That's the reason for having 35 days. And where it is a case that it's just not possible to do in that period because it's a large estate or a housing development, or there's some additional complexity to it, then we have an agreement at the outset with the applicant based on their understanding of the application, the amount of work to be done, and ours around how long that will take. That's the position we want to get to in order to give complete certainty across all of our applications to applicants about how long they will take us to process.
Okay, thank you. Graham Simpson.
Thank you. What's the longest outstanding case you've got?
Our oldest case is, unless it's gone in the last few days, 3rd of February 2017.
Okay. And why has that taken so long?
Chris will know exactly what the case is.
I maybe don't know the individual case. I think when the keeper was here, I think a couple of sessions ago, she said the reason why we had the organisation had a backlog prior to the pandemic, and we were making good progress in clearing that in the period 2018 to 2020. That case would have been gone but for the impact of the pandemic, which slowed down the rate that we were clearing cases. So the short answer is caused by the pandemic, a lack of capacity, and then focus on other cases. For the reasons I've given around upfront cases, around expedite cases and around other old cases, although we are now making much quicker progress on 2017 cases in particular. We reduced them, I think, by 49% in the year. They are coming down quite sharply, and we expect them all to be gone this calendar year.
And if I may just build on that, I think be keen to make sure the committee's aware. Last time we met, we talked about whether we would have the capacity to put some dedicated resource onto the very oldest cases. Up until that point, we'd been in the position of additional capacity was focused on expedite. We have had the capacity to put some people onto the older cases, which is why we're really driving down, and 2017 will get gone very soon. And then the good news, of course, is that surplus capacity can shift up to 2018 as we bring in automation, more capacity comes in. So Chris articulated the plan to accelerate the progress we're making. That's where that acceleration is going to come from.
I mean, I accept that things are improving, but you know, it's hard to accept that cases have taken 6 years, and you cannot blame the pandemic for a 6-year delay. You've got 6 years, 5 years, 4 years. you know, how have we gotten to that position?
Put very simply, by not having enough capacity at the more senior grades to deal with that volume of casework. That's why we're building that capacity and looking at ways to bring in automation. And I think I'm personally, and when I talk to solicitors, the expedite service is what they want. They don't want us to just start at the oldest case and work forward, because then there would be cases from 2019, 2020, or even, in fact, recent cases. We do get expedite requests for something that someone's just sent us because it's that urgent, they need it done as a priority. So, I mean, it's back actually to Mr. Halcrow-Johnson's or Mr. McDonald's question about the economic impact. The economic impact of us not having an expedite service by just having everything on the oldest cases would be much more significant, because then there would be cases stuck that people really need back. We are very, very clear that someone can come forward and request an expedite. There's now a very comprehensive list of criteria. Whoever has that 3rd of February 2017 case, it is clearly not the priority for them to get it back. I suspect that solicitor has expedited other cases, but it's not the one they've wanted us to do. And it's why we want to fix the problem. We don't like having a stock of long-standing open casework, and we do want to make sure it's gone.
So once you've cleared this backlog, what would be the longest that you would anticipate? I realise every case is different, some are really complicated, but what would be the longest you would anticipate a case taking once that backlog is gone?
I'll defer to Chris, who has direct experience of working on registration cases.
I think in the ordinary run of events, we wouldn't expect anything to be longer than 12 months, depending on the type of application. Right. You know, you could conceive of a very large estate with, you know, potentially hundreds of exceptions from the estate that need to be mapped, etc., that may take a touch longer. But generally, I think that would be our expectation, around 12 months.
OK. I've just got one more question, Convener, if it's OK. I was looking through the list of registers that you are responsible for. There's 21 of them. Some of them sound really quite fascinating. Register of the Great Seal, Register of the Quarter Seal, Register of the Cachet Seal, I hope that's pronounced correctly, Register of Service of Heirs, there's all sorts there. Which one of these registers takes up the most time for you, and are there any that take up no time?
The Land Register and the Sazine Register, by a very long way, are the biggest amount of registrations. The next set of registers that take up about 20% of our time are, in fact, interestingly, the Register of the Great Seal, the Register of Inhibitions, and the Register, the Court Registers, the sort of Register of Judgments. Yeah. They take up a bit of time, but they're dwarfed by the volume of transactions. Other registers, very few and far between in terms of applications, and therefore take almost no time, but we clearly maintain and deliver the service for them. So I don't know, Chris, if you wanted to add anything on that.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson.
Good morning. Thank you for attending today. You've mentioned it already, but I just wanted to dig a wee bit deeper in terms of your expedite service. Now, looking at the percentage success rate of applications to use the expedite service, I can see for the record that, you know, years ending 2020, 2021, it was 52% were approved. The following year, 2021 to 2022, was 49%. And then 2022 to 2023, it jumps to 77%, which is obviously good. So I wanted to explore with you, what was the reason for that? Has it been more purchasing power or volume throughput, if you like? Have you changed the criteria for by which cases can be expedited? That'd be useful to understand.
So this was a really good example of a detailed conversation with a variety of customers where when we first launched the expedite service, we said it's about, if you're going to suffer financial or personal hardship, request an expedite. What we've done in the last year, which I think has resulted in a greater success rate, is being much more explicit about a set of examples of what that might look like, types of deeds you might be registering, circumstances you might be in, whether or not we need to see evidence, which things we don't need to see evidence for. So there's much more comprehensive guidance on our website now. So I think people who are requesting an expedite are much clearer on what qualifies. Do they need to supply evidence? Because one of the reasons originally that a number of expedites weren't successful was people just go, can I have an expedite, please? This is my problem. And we would say, well, to make this a fair process for everyone, we need to see some evidence. And they'd go, oh, here you go, and send it in again. And then we would be able to expedite it. So I think that's the reason that we've been able to help customers really understand all the sorts of examples of things we've seen for expedite. But I think, again, I would emphasise, we will always consider an expedite request. If something we've never seen before has happened to someone and they want to come forward and explain the circumstances and say, this is why I want to expedite, the list on the website is a set of examples of things, not a comprehensive basis on which we would expedite.
I'm aware that you've seen the letter submitted from Mr. Keith Robertson. And in it, I have to refer to it because he also refers to me in a question I asked last time, and I'll just put it on the record. I had asked, and I quote, for the record then, you're saying that if solicitors who lodged cases in 2017 come to you with a request to expedite because of the time that they have already taken, you will agree to that. And the answer you gave was yes, 100%. Now, the assertion by Mr. Robertson is, and again, I quote, this is quite simply untrue. Length of time since submission is not and never has been accepted by ROS as grounds for expedition. So can you clear up that? Is he correct? Is he incorrect? What exactly is the position?
That was a little disappointing, but in his letter I was quoted with half of what I said. So for the record, I think it would be useful if I repeat what I actually said last time, where I said, in answer to your question about if someone came to us to request an expedite for a 2017 case, I said, yes, 100%. The numbers that Mr. Robertson will be quoting in his letter will be expedite cases where the submitting solicitor has come along and said, this is a priority. Now, could you please get this case done? And we've got it done. So I think my emphasis was, length of time we've had it is not a reason to expedite, but as just if we've had it since 2017 and someone comes along and explains why it's a priority, we would expedite it in the same way as we would expedite a 2018 or a 2019 case.
Okay. So I suppose, though, that takes you into kind of delay territory, because I'm thinking about an example where there's been a delay because there's been a change of circumstances with a solicitor or with the person. Will a client always be able to draw on the necessary data required to meet your criteria to be able to expedite it after that length of delay? You know, I'm using an example from 2017.
I mean, it may well be the case that a problem arises because we've had it a long time. I mean, a classic case could be a sad situation where somebody dies and the executor needs to now deal with their estate, and having the title fully registered helps that process, and that's absolutely the sort of example where an expedite would be appropriate. So something may have happened in the passage of time that makes an expedite now appropriate, but simply the passage of time in and of itself does not mean a case needs to be expedited. The example I gave earlier of a solicitor retiring, that's a good example where completing the set of cases from that solicitor are a good reason to expedite, because it would cause that solicitor significant personal inconvenience to have to think about what to do when he's retiring and he's still got open cases. But it's at the point in time that someone has a circumstance where getting that title complete and the evidence to support that. I don't know, Chris, do you want to expand on this, because you're more day-to-day involved in the discussions around this?
I think the thing that I would add is generally that expedites that we see, it is a current and present difficulty that the applicant is having, perhaps around a future transaction that they are wishing to sell on, and the purchaser is not keen to complete without a completed application. So the challenge tends not to be a historical one, it tends to be a present one, and therefore evidencing that is generally, in our experience, not a difficulty. Although, you know, as the keeper says, we are continually speaking to our customers about that, and if there are things we can do to improve that service and following those conversations, then we would do so.
And it's interesting to hear, I mean, you're clearly exercising judgment in that and looking at the kind of circuit, you know, the three criteria you set out. Actually, a couple of those examples don't appear to me to fit into those criteria. But I'm not having a pop, you're clearly exercising judgment. So is it fair to say that at this point the process, or rather the criteria for expedition, are still developing as you get more data and understanding of particular issues? Is that a fair comment?
I think the set of examples of what constitutes a personal hardship or a financial hardship are, you know, we're expanding the sort of list of things that sit underneath that to help people understand this is an example of something where an expedite might be appropriate. But we still stand by the sort of headline criteria are there is some personal or financial difficulty that either is arising or theoretically could arise. We absolutely accept expedites where people come forward and say, I'm about to do an equity release, very specialist mortgage. I know that mortgage lender really wants titles registered. I would like my title registered. I anticipate financial difficulties if my title isn't registered, and I could provide evidence and we would get on and do it. Okay. So I think it's right, we are exercising judgment, and we work with solicitors. It's back to my description of the customer relationship managers. When we say no to an expedite, we don't just say no and put the phone down. There's then a dialogue with the solicitor that says, just explain a bit more, kind of, what about this, and, you know, what can we do to help more broadly? So it is a service, not a kind of send it in, we decide, we send it back or not.
Mm-hmm. And my last question, in terms of, do you see then, or do you have the data, are you able to map it where this expedition process and it being more fulsome will eventually feed into starting to target the backlog? Because you have mentioned that some are historical cases where folk are saying, look, you know, we did really need to crack on now. Have you explored that link?
So I think expedite cases are in general cases in the backlog, not always. Sometimes they're things that so getting expedite cases done does help with the backlog. Mm-hmm. But what's really going to help with the backlog is having all that additional capacity able to target cases beyond the expedite, which is why, as I said earlier, we now do have the capacity to really drive down on the 2017, as well as keeping on top of all the expedites. The single thing customers have said to us is, it's really important the expedite service works. In fact, part of the feedback we had in a recent dialogue with customers, which is why we provided a bit more guidance on the website, was it really matters to us that when we request an expedite, we get it back really quickly. So could you reduce the time for an expedite? So we were, and I will follow up in writing if I don't quote the figures correctly, I think we were at 22 days for an expedite. We're now at 6 as the average. And customers said to us, that really matters, because when we want it back, we want it back. But on top of that, we've now got additional capacity to be bringing in from that oldest cases. So what I hope will start to happen is, before someone thinks, oh, I need to request my case from 2018, actually it's done, it's back with them, because the capacity we've released has done it anyway. That's where we're seeking to get to, where we're overtaking the expedite requests, if you like.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to bring in Colin Smith, to be followed by Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
Can I just ask a follow-up question? You mentioned that you work with solicitors to try to tackle some of these particular challenges. I notice in the most recent quarterly update to the committee in February, you explained the fact that you had an engagement event with the President and Chief Executive of the Law Society of Scotland. What was the mood in that discussion? What were the issues that they were raising with you direct?
So at the time, that was the relatively new president and relatively new chief exec. So that meeting was really to bring them up to speed on what we were doing in terms of our strategy in ROS. So clearing the open case work, getting to the point of bringing in digital services. They fed back that they had picked up that the open case work was an ongoing concern for their members. And we said, we're absolutely aware of that. And that's why we are out talking to customers about that. But I think it was a positive meeting where they were pleased to hear everything we were doing and supportive of the engagement we were having with them. Within the Law Society, we talk very regularly every month to their Property Law Committee, who are the people who are, I guess, hearing from members in the property sector about what we're doing.
Just, I suppose, another point on customer satisfaction. I notice in the corporate plan and the delivery plan that there's a number of KPIs relating to customer satisfaction. You obviously mentioned that the sort of citizen survey, but the KPIs relate very much to the satisfaction of businesses, as opposed to, I suppose, that wider group of citizens, if you like. And you know, that citizens survey did show that the satisfaction score had fallen from 91.1% in October 2022 to 87.8% in March 2023. Is there a reason why you don't have a KPI for that wider group of people? You only have a KPI for businesses?
There has been a reason, I suppose, in that the vast majority of the people who deal directly with us are solicitors. So, you know, most people who have an application for registration, it's their solicitor who sends it in. But that's also the reason why we measure both things, because we are very interested in where a citizen has a direct experience of coming to us for something, usually to request information. How satisfied are they with the issue? Until we started with the Institute of Customer Services, we didn't have an ability to differentiate between business customers and citizen customers. It's that new way of surveying that's given us the ability to split them out. So I see no reason why going forward we wouldn't want to set a KPI around citizen satisfaction. Now we've had a year of sort of benchmarking, but prior to that we had no benchmark for it. So I think it is something we could look to introduce as a KPI going forward, because it is as important to us that the citizens who deal directly with us are satisfied with the service as the professional customers. So having two KPIs would be something we could definitely do.
Thank you. I'm going to change the order of questions a bit, and I'll ask the next question around rejections of applications. Now, there is a commitment to not reject applications after 3 months unless it's legally impossible not to do so. But the rejections over 3 months have steadily increased. There seemed to have been a slight drop in the most recent year, but there has been an increase over the year, so that there's now over 4,000 applications that are over 3 months old that have been rejected. What do you think the reasons are for that? I think you've indicated it could be solicitors' inaccuracies, and how do you resolve the issues that are causing the problem?
I'll start at a high level, but I'll ask Chris to come in on the details. So, bluntly, when we reject an application, it's because it is not legally possible to proceed with registering it in the form we have it in. So this committee will remember we removed a rejection. We used to charge a fee for rejecting. So we're interested. We don't yet know. We haven't got enough data to know, is there some sort of link between the fact there's no longer any kind of penalty from a solicitor point of view for having something rejected? Has that caused the slight rise? We do everything we can to educate solicitors about what mistakes we are typically seeing, what people are getting wrong, why we're having to reject. We run a regular webinar called How to Avoid Rejections. But I'll get Chris to come in on the detail on more, you know, sort of typical reasons for rejection, and to illustrate to the committee why we have to send things back.
Well, I suppose just add to that, Chris, before you come in, I'd be interested in the reason about why you think it's increased year on year. Is it, you know, since 2018 it was 476, and the most recent year it's 1,042. So I do understand you're taking, you have webinars and you're trying to educate people on how to use the system, but the numbers are still going up rather than reducing it.
Yeah, so I think there's probably a couple of things to look at. So as you mentioned, the commitment is not to reject applications after we've had them for 3 months. So what we say is, there is in general and in principle a one-shot rule for applicants. They should get their application right first time. The keeper's duty on that side of the equation is to complete the upfront check very quickly to make sure that we are content the application can proceed. So you have applications being checked at solicitor offices and then checked at the keeper's office. And then in most cases, then we'll identify the problem at that stage. and the rejection rate there is running at about 10%. Those are cases where the applicant, the solicitor, has made some form of mistake, sent in the wrong documentation, perhaps the deed is not properly signed in terms of the requirements of the Writing Act. That rate, I think, is too high for us. We think the rate should be much closer to 4%, lower than that if possible. And that's the work the keeper refers to around trying to improve the quality of applications we're getting in, because pushing applications back the way is not what we want to be doing, and that uses up capacity that could otherwise be clearing applications out of the process. The other issue then is what you might call late stage rejections. So rejections that happen when the application has been with us for a while, and we appreciate the difficulty that they can cause. We want to do what we can to minimise and reduce them. So every single one of those rejections, there will be a conversation between one of our senior advisors or our senior registration officers and the submitting applicant about the best course to take with that application. And sometimes the best course to take is to start the application again. And that will generally be an agreement reached between our colleagues and the submitting applicant. In some cases, that can be avoided through submission of additional information, and where that's possible, we do that. And then I guess the final line, if you like, of defence on that is, if there is some scenario, some intervening or supervening event that has happened, which means it is difficult or impossible for the solicitor to provide the keeper with the additional information she would ordinarily require, it is open to the keeper to take a view and register the title as it is, and that is what we would do in those cases.
Mm-hmm. And have you had to, because I think we previously did discuss this with the keeper, the issue of the loss of initial registration date, that can be difficult for, but you're suggesting it's a small number of people and that there are special measures in place, and have you had to use, it's a small number of people, but have you had to use these kind of special measures or different approach?
So we'll be using those measures, and the rejections in that case will be highly context specific, so it depends on what's the nature of the transaction, what is the nature of the problem with the application, and what is the nature of the kind of supervening event that may have happened, whether it's bankruptcy of the seller or sequestration of the seller or some difficulty like that. So it will be, they are low in volume, it will be very context specific, and we have employed those kind of mitigations and discussions with the submitting applicant where we need to.
Okay.
Thanks. If I may just add one additional thing we do to try and help solicitors avoid rejections, part of the design of our digital systems is we try and design out the possibility of people getting things wrong. So one of the issues we have is solicitors can sometimes send us the deed that is not the deed that actually relates to the thing they're trying to register. We can't clearly proceed on that basis. Are there things we can do in the way we design our digital systems to make sure you cannot upload the wrong deed, or you at least are asked, are you really sure this is the deed you want to send before you hit submit and things like that? So we are trying to make it as easy as possible for people to not make the mistakes that mean we have no choice but to reject.
Okay. Thank you. Now, can I ask about completing the land register? Having the advantages over the Saysound register? Because we've discussed this before. So the original plan, the policy launch in 2014, was to complete the land register by 2024. But it's become clear that that target's not going to be reached anytime soon. But I think in previous discussions, it's also been anytime soon means possibly never, because what the ambition is now is to deliver the benefits of a completed land register, but you still have the two systems operating. So it's maybe just an update on where we are with that. And also there has been a change, if I'm correct, to the way in which properties are registered, that the property addresses had been dropped and the one to landmass has been retained. Was that quite recently? And maybe explain why that decision's been made and what the impact of that could be.
Thank you, Chris. And I will answer the question between us. I guess perhaps just useful to recap what we're doing to deliver the benefits for complete land register. So there's two purposes of having a complete land register. One is about transparency of ownership of land in Scotland. And we realised some time ago that not all the land is going to come onto the land register, either through sale or voluntary registration, and that's something without our control. So we asked ourselves, what can we do with the information we already hold to provide better information for citizens in Scotland to get that transparency of ownership? And that's where we're very fortunate to have the SAISIN register. The problem with the SAISIN register, it doesn't have a map. So we started to think, how could we create the mapping for the SAISIN register that would allow people to look at a map of Scotland, understand the ownership? So that's what our Unlocking SAISIN's work is about, and that's how we're now at having 90.7% of the landmass of Scotland, where we have that link between a shape on a map and ownership information. And one of the things the committee may have spotted in our delivery plan for year two is, now we've got that, this is the year we're going to start releasing that data for people who want to consume it and use it and make policy decisions. So that deals with the Who Owns Scotland question. We fully acknowledge it's not as perfect as if everything was on the land register, but it's as good as we can do, given we don't control everything coming onto the land register. The other reason for completing the land register is to make sure that if something is likely to transact, it's already on the land register. And that's where the number of addresses comes in. And the reason we've currently dropped that as a KPI is because the number of addresses is constantly increasing, because every time a house developer gets permission to build a new set of houses, it gets a bunch of new addresses issued, but we haven't got those addresses to register. So there's always a mismatch between how many addresses are out there and how many we could be receiving to register. So we still track that internally, but it's not a very meaningful thing externally, because it can go up and down. If Ordnance Survey add 10,000 new addresses, the percentage can drop, but it's not because things have come off the register, it's just because we haven't yet been given those 10,000 things to register.
So at the moment it says that it's paused. Does that mean it's...
It's paused as a KPI while we work out what's a more meaningful thing to keep reporting on. Because what's actually, I think, a meaningful thing to report on is how many new addresses have been created in Scotland and how many new addresses have been added to the register. And are you seeing that tracking up in parallel? And where we want to get to in terms of getting everything onto the land register that might transact is so that if you have a transaction, it sails through, it's invisible to you whether your property's been on the land register forever, has just come on or hasn't come on. But I think Chris will speak a little bit to the challenge of what do we do as we start to reach the limit of properties that haven't sold for a very long time wanting to come onto the register, and how we make sure that's speedy.
Can do if you wish.
So
I think... I'll just pick up very, very briefly on functional completion. I think the Keeper is right in her assessment. It's not an intuitively kind of simple thing to understand, I think, is what we've found with stakeholders and customers. We were using addresses as a bit of a proxy measure for, is this property likely to transact or not? And as the Keeper mentions, the numbers there are fluctuating all the time. So we think the better approach is to monitor that internally and to say, well, the benefit of a land register title is the application is quick and consistent. And as we improve the position in first registrations, then they will be equally as quick and consistent as dealings with land register titles, which is the way that we will resolve that problem. In terms of landmass coverage, I think we are close to probably reaching the limits of what we can do with unlocking SAISINs. We think there's probably around another 3 or 4% that we can add through identifying SAISIN search sheets which relate to areas of land and giving them a kind of spatial extent for people to look at. Beyond that, I think we are right into the margins of titles which are pre the SAISIN register, so land ownership that stems from prior to 1617. Think about some of the ancient universities and other things where we've got no source data on that at all, and we would obviously require to, you know, speak to those landowners. And the other kind of challenging area will be small slivers of land that are between large estates that may have fallen by the wayside of either title. And I think we probably will in due course need a discussion about how much effort do we expend in trying to identify ownership of those areas and the value of doing so, because it gets very difficult and time consuming when you're in the margins there, I think.
Mm-hmm. And just because you've mentioned financing, is it correct? So this work, the voluntary registrations and the keeper induced registration, was partly funded by the financial reserve model that you had previously. And now you've heard earlier in questions that's not the financial model for the organisation. So it's just to you, in terms of resourcing this piece of work, is that you've said now you're going to be getting to bits of land that is quite difficult and quite resource intensive. That will mean financially commitment as well.
Yeah. So I think there is resource allocated to complete the unlocking Sazines work that we've mentioned. We are not currently spending any resource on keeper and juice registration. Voluntary registrations attract a fee, although there is a reduced fee for them. So as and when voluntary registrations come in, we do process them. I think I'd return to kind of keeper and juice registration, which is really the lever that the keeper, the only lever the keeper has, will be dependent on making sufficient progress in the backlog, will be dependent on whether it's affordable at that stage, and will be dependent really on whether the titles we are looking at are susceptible to keeper and juice registration. Keeper and juice registration is we have used so far to kind of plug the gaps in housing estates where the boundaries are clear, we know the historic pattern of ownership, and we can envision what a title sheet looks like quite simply. It's slightly more difficult to envision how you would do that for more complex land holdings. So I think it's probably unlikely that keeper and juice registration carries much weight there.
Okay. Graeme Simpson, did you wish to have a supplementary?
Yeah, really it was around what the convener was asking about the rejection of applications. And if I heard you right, you said that 10% were rejected, often because of mistakes made by solicitors, which strikes me as quite a high number. That one in 10 applications are rejected because the solicitor makes a mistake. That has to be a huge concern. Do you keep a list? I wouldn't expect you to publish a list, but do you maybe keep an internal list of who are the worst offenders? And do you also have a list of what are the top mistakes that are being made?
Both, we, particularly on the sort of reasons for rejection, we get a detailed report every week, and we actually share that report with the Law Society, not named firms, but as in what are the top reasons for having to reject. So just to, top reason at the moment is that the witness hasn't signed the deed. I mean, that is a fairly straightforward thing that would need to be done, but we have to send it back. But there's a sort of league table of the different reasons. And it's all the same reasons, which is why we run this regular webinar, which is one of the things that aren't got correct. We do know which firms have which issues, and our customer relationship managers do have conversations where appropriate to say, you are making this, not getting this correct more often than other people, so that people can think about whether they want to change their processes in their firms to iron out those issues.
It's extraordinary. I mean, it just seems so basic of signing something that should be bread and butter to a solicitor, you would have thought. Now, I know you said you don't charge if a solicitor's made a mistake, but do you think the solicitor is charging their client?
I can't speak to that. I mean, we did used to have a rejection fee, so we would make a charge for the having had to look at the application, say we're going to send it back, and we got rid of that charge because we got to the point where the administration of the charge was not worth it for the processes. But I can't speak to what the solicitors may be doing in terms of what they do when they have to correct something.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you to Jennifer Henderson and Chris Kerr for coming in this morning. Much appreciate the evidence. And I will briefly suspend the meeting to move to private session.